John chapter 14. Yes.
Okay. Turn to John chapter 14.
Okay. Raise your Bibles up in the air while you turn them away. Say, today,
today
I choose
to experience life.
Life begins
with salvation.
And life is developed
through
spiritual growth. And life is shared
through us
being witnesses
of His great love.
This is the word of life.
And this word of life
is living in us.
And this word of life
is the light
of all men.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Rosa. I was ready to run. I got down five ways, but I'm probably just going to do four ways to find God's peace in difficult situations.
Well,
I want to turn to John 14:27. If I were to allow you to look behind the veil into pastors' lives, probably one of the most challenging areas of pastoring or ministering or being in leadership in any way as it relates to ministry and really, really life is maintaining peace. Because we all get attacked. We all go through stuff. And for us, I think sometimes we get a double punch because he feels like, the enemy feels like, if he can crush us, if he can get us off, if he can knock us down, then it's not just going to hurt or damage who we are or what we are. It's going to also impact those who see us. So we get a double punch sometimes, but the good news is if we called and we're called for real, we're fortified. We might get blown over, but we don't get blown out.
Amen.
We might get blown over a little bit, but we don't get blown up. I don't think that's good English, but blown up. Praise the Lord. It's critical to know who you are, and what you're doing is what God told you to do. And I think maybe sometimes in our life, we see people who are in positions that they have hardships and things happen, but they may be in the wrong position and may be trying to do something that they want to do versus doing what God has told them to do. So it's critical for us to make sure that we are where we're supposed to be, doing what we've been called to do, and operating in faith and operating in grace and mercy. Does that make sense? So I wanted to just say that because I think in all of your lives, you are dealing with some area that's attacking your peace. Don't look at me with them religious eyes, spiritual eyes. You're dealing with peace. Otherwise, he wouldn't have woke me up at 4 o'clock in the morning and changed my message. You're dealing with peace. You're dealing with maintaining and holding on to your peace. He said, I'll keep you in perfect peace. Whose minds are stayed on me. So we understand that peace is going to be directly dealing with you and how you manage your mind. How you manage your mind is going to be critical going forward. And I know this is for us. And when I say us, it's me too. How we manage our thought life and how we manage our mind. So I guess the first thing I want to do is I want to define peace. And you see in John 14, verse 27, Jesus says this. He says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I don't give you as the world gives. So don't let your heart be troubled. See, my peace is not like the world's peace. So to define it, the first thing you really want to understand is the peace of God is not the peace of this world.
Amen.
It's not the same. So many times we see, and when I was even putting this down, I thought about the World Beauty Pageant. And when they have them, they ask them the questions. The universe, Miss Universe and all, and they ask them the questions. And it seems to be a patented answer, I guess, when they don't really know what else to say. They'll say, world peace. I want world peace.
Yep.
Peace of the world. Well, what they mean is they want everybody to stop fighting.
Yes.
We want no wars. We don't want conflict in any way. That is not the same peace that God supplies. The peace that God supplies can be in the middle of fights. In the middle of conflict. In the middle of war, you can have peace even though that's going on. So it's important to understand when we hear God says, I supply a peace that surpasses all understanding, it is not the same as world peace.
No, it's not.
Because his peace that he supplies overrides whatever the circumstance or situation is.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
That's what you got to understand. When we're talking about peace, everything else can be going crazy. And you can be just standing there. And people will say, how in the world can you keep yourself together in the middle of this turmoil? Well, it's because you're holding on to God's peace. And I had a great word from God one time. He shared something with me about ministry. And he shared a number with me. And it was a big number. And I said, Lord, how in the world can you contain that many people to do this? And he came right back to me. And he said this, you can't do it in the world. In other words, I was thinking from a natural perspective. His answer was, really what he was saying was, you can't do this in the natural. And that's what peace he's talking about. Having peace in the circumstance, you can't do it in the natural. Does that make sense to anybody? That peace is beyond natural.
Yes.
So the definition is for God's peace is beyond natural worldly peace.
Yes.
So you can split the two. You can separate those and not feel like that you have to have what the world defines it as in order for you to have it.
Well,
that's true. Okay. Amen? So Jesus was talking about the gift of the Holy Spirit when he's talking about peace I leave you. He explained that he would be going away, but he was leaving the Holy Spirit to personally guide and give us peace.
Yes.
So you have to not let your heart be troubled. See, if you see it at the end, it says, so let not your heart be troubled. And I wrote it down like this. It's your job to keep your heart out of trouble. Isn't that good? You know how folks get in trouble all the time? You get in trouble, so it's your job to keep your heart out of trouble. Job to make sure we keep our hearts out of trouble. Now, I had an incident that took place 2 years ago, the MRI situation. Was it 2 years ago? Maybe a year? Y'all that's visiting, I had claustrophobia. The fear of closed-in places. We went to Disney World one time, and we were with the kids, and we got in a ride. And I didn't let them know. But I was sitting in there tripping. All them kids sitting in there having a good time, and I'm sitting in there like this. Why? Because I had claustrophobia. The fear of closed-in places. It was actually an animated ride where you get in and you sit down and there's nothing but a screen. We were sitting in a building. That's all. We weren't on no ride. We weren't flying. We weren't doing nothing. We were just sitting there looking at a screen. I'm sitting there like this. Trying not to let them know I was tripping. Closed-in area, and it, you know, screen comes on, and you know, all it does is lean to the side and lean forward, and it gives you the appearance that you're in a rocket ship. And I'm sitting in there just tripping because I had a fear of closed-in places. If you know the story, when I was young, me and a buddy, good old buddy. That's how things normally happen. Said, let's play Army. And I said, okay. So he took me to his house right around the corner, and he had a drain. Oh right there. God. Oh yeah, you know where this, you know where this is going. He had a drain right in their driveway. The Army game was to go into the drain, shimmy all the way across, and come out on the other side. Because that was Army. The drain was about from here to that window. He gets in. Now, remind you, he's smaller than me. He gets in the drain. And I'm looking. He's shimmying over. He got on through, and he got to the other side and jumped up and said, your turn! I said, oh, okay. I get in. I ain't really feeling good about this. But I started going through. And when I got about right here, I panicked and got stuck. He's standing there, and all I could see was his feet take off and run. And I just started crying. His big brother came and coaxed me out. Come on. He said, just take your time. Come on. He coaxed me out. From that day on, I was afraid of closed-in places. Until, and I probably was about 6, 7 years old, till last year, and I'm 65, this will be 66. Until then, I was afraid of closed-in places. Now, I had to have an MRI. I walked out on MRIs, y'all. I would walk in and see that thing, and they said, are you going to go in there? And I would just say, I'm getting in there, and just walk out. Didn't matter what the medical situation was, what I was checking on, what I needed to see, I walked out. And it came to a point where I said, you know what? I can't allow fear to run my life like this. I could be walking out on something that's serious.
That's right.
That I need to know about, I need to pray about, I need to put the Spirit of God on, I need to put the healing message of the Word of God on it, and I'm running from it because I'm in fear. That's a word for somebody right there.
Amen.
You can allow fear to run you out of what God has already supplied for you.
Amen.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So I had this MRI. And the guy said, you don't have any, doctor said, you don't have any trouble in getting enclosed in place. I said, well, I do have a little bit of problem. He said, no problem. We'll give you something. You can take it, and you can go right on in there. Something about that didn't sit right with me.
No.
And the Holy Spirit said this. He said, now, if you take this just to get through this, you'll have to take something every time you face something. You'll have to take something to get through it. And if you're going to win, you got to be able to win without drugs.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So I said, you're right, God, I got to do this. I got to win over this. If I can't win over this, I can't win over stuff other than this.
Amen.
I got to win. I can't be the preacher, man, telling you that you can win over fear. And I'm taking sedatives to go through an MRI.
Amen.
Am I right? If you're going to be real,
yes,
I don't want to be no fake preacher.
If
it comes up, I got to face it.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yes,
so I said, okay, I'm going to win on this. Miriam said, okay, you need me to drive you? Because, you know, if you have to take the medicine, I'm going to have to drive you home. I said, no! I'm going to be fine. I had it in my pocket. I went to the place. I got in the place, and I'm sitting there. I said, Lord, you're going to have to help me. You're going to have to help me get through this. Watch this. So I'm sitting there. They bring a little basket and say, you got to put all your belongings in this little basket.
Mm-hmm.
I put my keys, my wallet, and that medication in that basket.
Mm-hmm.
I had crossed the point
of no return.
And I'm showing up seeking God. I'm saying, Lord Jesus, come on now. Come on, Lord Jesus. So we go. Take me to the room. I change clothes. They put me in the little gown thing, and I'm sitting in there. I said, Lord, you got to help me. You got to help me right now. You got to help me. Because I got to go through this. I can't not do this. I got to do this without drugs. And so while I was sitting there, the Spirit of God said this to me. I am the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding. Watch this. The scripture says, will guard or keep your heart and your mind.
Yes.
I said, wait a minute. You mean to tell me your peace can keep my heart and my mind? And I had a picture of a centurion guard. Standing guard, holding a rifle. And behind him was my mind and my heart. And he's standing guard. I said, you mean to tell me you can stand guard over my thoughts and over my heart to protect it? I said, I got it. I said, and I'm sitting in this room by myself. I said, I got it. I said, you're telling me that your peace can stand like a soldier? Guarding my thoughts and guarding my heart. So I can tell that peace to not allow fear to come past it to get to my thinking or to get to my heart. You're telling me I can do that? I said, I'll do it. I got it. So when they said, by that time, that's right, you ready? I said, I'm ready. I'm ready. I walked in there. I saw that machine. I said, I'm ready. I said, Holy Spirit, peace, I'm calling on you now. Guard my thinking. Do not allow fear to come into my thoughts. Watch this. Little babies, little boys, little girls get in this thing, and they be sitting there laughing and playing while that thing going on. I am not afraid of this MRI machine. I am not. I got in that thing and I laid down. I am not afraid. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, peace. God, my thoughts. I'm not afraid of this. And about halfway through the thing, the lady came on there and said, well, you know, we got about five more minutes. I said, go ahead, do what you got to do. Go ahead. I was sitting there like this. I got this. We good. And when I came out, she said, okay, you're done. I said, praise the Lord. And I got out, and when she pulled me out of there, I said, well, praise the Lord. She said, I ain't never had nobody come out of here and say that. ain't never had nobody come out and say that. the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall God keep your heart and your mind.
Amen.
So, number one, separate lies from the truth. Number one, separate lies from the truth. Psalms 34:14, go there. Psalms 34:14. When we're facing trials, we often let our minds wander to the worst case scenario. Can anybody relate to that?
Yes, sir.
We entertain our fears and we let them rule our hearts. The psalmist warns us against that. So when we feel something, oh Lord, I believe that's a lump on my leg. Oh Lord, I believe that might be cancer. Ain't nothing but a mosquito bite. You're taking it all the way over there. Because the enemy's job is to encourage you to think negatively and think the worst case. How many of y'all know what I'm talking about? Anybody here done that before? Yeah, we think the worst case scenario. So, in the name of Jesus, we can have the ability now to separate lies from the truth. Psalm 34:14 says, and I got it in the CSB translation, but it says, turn away from evil and do what is good. Notice this last part. Seek peace and pursue it. Now, we have to go after peace. You can't embrace the worst case scenario and go after peace at the same time. You have to have a made up mind. In this situation, I'm going hard after peace. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
I'm getting this. This is good for me. Praise the Lord. I need to sit right there and listen to it. Yeah, you got to go after peace. You got to know the difference between lies and the truth. We actually, and I wrote this down, we actually have to pivot from the lies of the enemy and bask in God's truth. The word pivot is an interesting word. When I hear pivot, I think basketball. I think basketball. When you pivot, watch this. You actually turn away from the opponent. Once you dribble a basketball, you stop dribbling. Now you have to pivot away from the trouble. If he's here or if he's there, you pivot. You pivot. It's turning away from where the enemy is. It's turning away. It's turning away. It's turning away. It's turning away. You can't walk away. You have to turn away.
Yes.
And usually when you pivot, you're moving away from the threat of danger.
Yes.
You move away from it by pivoting away. You can't, because you picked up your dribble. You can't walk away, that's traveling. You can't dribble again, then that's traveling. So you got to play by the rule, and the rule is to pivot. Keep them to your backside. If they come around that, you pivot away from them again. You keep them away from you. Particularly in the basketball. So when I read that and when I put that down, pivot it away, okay, we can do that. So God has given us the ability now to separate lies from truth. You pivot away from the lie and you pivot toward the truth. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So you can't do that though without faith. Faith is the ability to see what God says as the truth and not your natural situation. Number two, surrender control to one who controls it all. This is a challenge. Because in order for him to have it, you have to let go. In order for Miriam to have this, I have to let it go. And a lot of times, this is what we do. God is trying to take it, and we're fighting to hold on to it.
Yo, yeah.
Because some of us like to be in a bad place. Because then we can get some sympathy.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
you like being in that place of you getting some of that.
Oh, poor, oh Lord, look at you. Lord, what can I do for you? Can I do anything for you? Well, yeah, I could have some dinner and some snacks. I know you're busy, but I could use some snacks. Why? Because we like the place of some of that. Does that make sense to anybody? So, but in order to be delivered, you got to let go.
Yes.
Sympathy is not deliverance.
No, it's not.
Sympathy is not deliverance.
No, it's not.
Having folks come over to you, all, giving you attention. Mm-hmm. Getting attention is not deliverance.
No, it's not, man.
The difference between the two is deliverance is freedom.
Yes.
You can get attention and still be bound.
Still be bound. Yep. That's good. Yes, sir.
Does that make sense to anybody?
Yes.
So number two, surrender control to the one who controls it all. Our greatest mistake in times of challenge is to take control ourselves and look to solve it and instead of first obtaining God's gift of peace. I'm guilty because me and my smart self feel like I can handle it. I can figure this out. I can see it, the process. I can work this process, and I can figure this out.
Well,
and that is our worst enemy.
That's right.
Oh, I'm the only one. Y'all looking at me like that. Y'all looking at me like that.
That's true.
Yeah. We have to realize that God knows better than us.
Yes, he does.
And really, to be honest with y'all, these two go together. Separate lies from the truth and then surrendering control to the one who controls it all. They really kind of go together. Because when you know the truth, you don't have a problem letting God have it.
Amen.
Does that make sense?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So say this after me. Lord,
help me
to grab peace
as my way
of dealing
with my situation.
Help me to grab peace.
Grab peace.
As a way of dealing with my situation. Oh, wait, that's good. Grabbing peace means letting go.
There you go.
Yeah.
Can you see that?
Amen.
Grabbing peace means releasing. It's almost like an oxymoron. Grabbing means releasing. Is that an oxymoron? I'm a doctor. See that? See how that happened right there? I'm a doctor. Grabbing means releasing. That's an oxymoron. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Say let it go.
Let it go.
Say let it go.
Let it go.
Number three, meditate on scriptures to encourage your heart. One of the practical ways to find peace is by writing out and doing scriptural confessions. We do those confessions in pre-service, and we do those confessions. Why? Because the Word of God is in the confessions. The power of God is in the confessions. It's in the Word. Here's the idea. Develop a scrapbook.
That written right there, the Word.
Or a notebook in which season in your life where you write out verses that encourage and bring you hope. Just write out scriptures that really kind of speak to you about encouraging you in the situation that you're in. Does that make sense to anybody?
Yes.
When we focus our minds on the truth in scripture, we don't have space to stress and worry. You can't worry and be in faith at the same time.
Amen.
Amen.
So here's about three I'm going to give you right quick. Psalm 37:25 says, I have been young and now I'm old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor their seed begging for bread. That's a real good one right there. Because you have understanding how you live your life and you stand with God and your focus in righteousness, not you being righteous because of you, but your righteousness because of God, but you're doing the right things,
yes.
Then you're actually protecting your offspring.
Amen. Amen.
You're guaranteeing that your descendants won't be begging for bread. They won't be begging for physical food, and they won't be begging for the word.
Amen.
That's good. Second one is Proverbs 16:7. When a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies. He make them have peace.
Yes.
And they mad at, they hate. They hate us. And he'll make your haters stop hating you.
Amen.
And don't even know why. You know, I hate them, but I don't understand why I hate them. Matter of fact, he'll make them help you.
That's right.
You know, I can't stand that joker, but I'm going to look out for him today.
Uh-huh.
Can anybody relate?
Exactly.
And then Philippians 2:5 says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So we can let our minds align with God's mind, which is probably one of the most powerful things you can ever do. Because as a man thinketh in his heart.
So is he.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So that's just three. It's hundreds of them. But I want to keep it short. Number four. And this is interesting. You can listen to worship music. You can listen to worship music. Music is another way to fix our minds on God's truth and to calm our fears and our emotions.
Yes.
1 Samuel 16, you don't have to turn there, 1 Samuel 16, David played his lyre or his harp or his instrument for Saul, who was being attacked by a harmful spirit. He was troubled in his spirit. So David pulled out his instrument and started playing and literally affected his emotions.
Yes.
Now, I got this point I want to make about that. So, it's important that we remember it's the Spirit of God that you are giving place to and not the music itself.
All right.
It's not the music, it's what's coming through the music. It's music is the vehicle. So it's critical that you align the music with scripture, with positive scripture and worship that is honoring God and that is honoring God's hand and is honoring his word and honoring who he is and speaking out who the Lord is to us in our life. Before I say what I'm saying. And indeed, it should be scripture and focused on being God-inspired. Watch this. So if worship music can bring peace like it did in Saul's life, what does worldly music bring? If the music that David played brought peace to Saul, what does worldly music bring? You can't say nothing. Because we see right here that peace traveled through worship that David played for Saul. Now, it didn't say anything about him singing any words. It didn't say anything about any lyrics. He just said he pulled out his instrument. And just started playing. He just pulled out his instrument and started playing. He didn't sing a note. That should tell you.
That's right.
Music is a vehicle.
It's a vehicle.
Well, I know what you're saying, Pastor.
I believe what you're saying. But every now and then, I got to listen to a little Keith Sweat.
Wow, hey, girl, wow.
I got to listen to a little Teddy Pendergrass. You know, I'm from the old school. She said, you know, if you don't go back there and get my own, she said, turn off the light. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. Oh, she said, don't. Don't turn off the light.
I feel like a little mad blue.
So, we thought that was just good music. We was feeding ourselves a bunch of men. And we wonder why our kids are in the situation sometimes they in, and even us are in our situations, because we fed ourselves with lust, thinking that it was all right. Yeah, we were singing that song just thinking, oh, what a great song. We was talking about adultery. Yeah. That song was adultery. And we just sang that, oh, we got a thing going on. No, that's adultery. We just highlighted it like it was no big deal. So music has had, and music is a vehicle, y'all. We can't act like that we don't understand that. Now you got the word, you understand that now. So now watch this. Can I take it deeper? Every Christian song ain't Christian. Not every Christian song has the right spirit behind it. Because if David was able to affect Saul through playing the instrument, it wasn't the instrument, it wasn't the song, it was what used it as a vehicle. David was a man of God.
Yes.
He was a man after God's own heart. So when he played something, the heart of God came through him and through the instrument and through him.
Yes.
That's key.
Yes.
It's who it is.
Yes.
Not just what the song is.
That's right.
Ooh, boy. It's a big, I can't call her name, but I call one. It's a big difference between C.C. Wilder and a lot of other folks.
Yes, sir.
C.C. Wilder can sing a song and put you on your face.
Yes, Lord.
And then some other folks can sing a song, Christian song. Mm-mm. And you can say, sounds good.
Uh-huh.
Oh, that's really true. They really can sing. But we're not talking about the same thing. So does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm going to let that go. All right. So don't get mad. It's just truth. Truth shall make you free.
Yes.
And then watch this. Number five. Realize that God himself is peace. God himself is peace. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. So when you're in the Word, you're with God, and the Bible says God himself is peace. Now watch this. 2 Thessalonians 3:16. We'll close here. 2 Thessalonians 3:16. Notice this says, now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace always in every way. May the Lord of peace himself. May the Lord of peace himself. May the Lord of peace himself. The Lord of peace himself. Give you peace always in what?
By all means.
And another translation say, in every way. God himself is peace, which means his word is peace.
Because his word is him.
Yes.
And it brings you peace.
Amen.
That makes sense?
Yes, sir.
So God wanted to say this to you today. There's no question in my mind for my wife to get up and say, God's giving me a word, and his word was about peace. And he changed my message from manifested blessings to peace. Must mean that it's critical for us this morning that we operate in God's peace. We can't let unforgiveness, strife, anger, malice, gossip get in the way of us having our peace. Because we hold on to those, then we're letting go of the peace that God has supplied for us. And I don't know about y'all, there's plenty of people to be angry at.
Amen.
I know plenty of people that we can be mad at. And a lot of times, we're mad at ourselves.
Yes.
Because we feel like we didn't do what we should have, or we missed it in some area. But even the words you shared was, God's not mad at you, he's not upset at you, he's okay. You know, even though you missed it, it's okay, because the grace of God and the mercy of God are there. So going forward, y'all, let's put a premium on the peace of God.
Amen.
Let's put a premium on it so that we can allow God's peace to keep us out of going through these peak and valley emotions.
Amen.
Because regardless of what's going on around us, the peace of God can keep us in the midst of it. Amen?
Amen.
Y'all get anything from that?
Yes.
Isn't God good?
Amen.
Well, praise the Lord. Well, if you're here today and you care to give your life to Christ, and you've never given your life to Christ, then I want to encourage you today to make that decision. It's critically important that you do that. God has a plan for you. With all heads bowed and all eyes closed, I want to do this. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall perish, but shall have and enjoy everlasting life. If you're here today and you've never been born again, I didn't ask you if you joined the church. I didn't ask you if you just got baptized, because you can get baptized and not be saved. How is that, Pastor? Well, you can just get baptized because somebody told you to do it, like me when I was 6. I got baptized because my mom and daddy told me. I didn't have a clue what it was about. So you can do it, and you really just get wet. Or you can make a firm, conscious decision to submit yourself to the Spirit of God and declare him as Lord of your life. If that's you and you believe you need to declare yourself as Lord, declare him as Lord over your life, and take the proper steps to walk out the process, then you can just lift your hand in the air and we'll pray that prayer together. Also, if you're here today and you have asked God to be Lord of your life, but you, for whatever reason, walked away from your commitment and decided you wanted to just go back out in the world and nothing was working for you, then I want to encourage you to rededicate your life today. God loves you so much. He has a great plan for you.
Amen.
He's not mad at you. He's quick to forgive. So if you feel like that you've walked away from your commitment to him and you really need to rededicate your life, we'll just pray the prayer of rededication. It's real simple. And you can do that right where you are. Can you see anybody? Anybody? So thirdly, if you're here and you don't have a church home and you believe the Spirit of God is saying to you that you should connect with this local church, then I want to encourage you to do that. God has a plan for you, and it directly connected to where you are.
Where?
God is not obligated to do what he desires to do for you out of the position that you be in, out of the position that he wants you in. And then finally, if you're here and you've never been filled with the Spirit, the Bible evidence of speaking with new tongues, that's for every born-again believer. He said, ye shall be filled with power. Ye shall receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And that power is for you to be able to be a witness and to go out and to operate in a supernatural way. Just a great, great gift. I'm so honored and so excited that I had the opportunity to be filled and use it on a regular basis. Why? Because my natural thinking is not enough. I can operate above my natural simply because God says I supply this gift for you to live a supernatural life. If you have any interest, just let us know. We'd be glad to pray for you. We'd be glad to give you any information. In Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, again, did y'all get something from this today? What is good? This information? Amen. So let's just operate in that peace today. Let's operate in that peace that I just want to tell you that I declare in Jesus' name that God operates on your life, and the peace of God will guard your heart and mind. Put that soldier to work.
Amen.
Put that soldier that guards your mind and your heart. Put him in position and declare, fear you will not cross this line. Yes. I will not be afraid.
Yes.
Because I have a guard over my heart and my mind. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we thank you. We give you all the glory and praise and honor. And we thank you so much for this day. We receive your word today and we declare that it has already begun to produce in our hearts and our minds and in our lives. And we give you all the glory for it. In Jesus' name. And everybody say,
amen.